like to invite here Stefan Klein. He's an associate professor in medical image analysis, and he's currently leading the image registration group within the biomedical imaging group in Rotterdam at Erasmus Medical Center. Together with Meyer Staring, he is responsible for the development of Elastix, an open source software package for image registration that is based on the ITK package. So that's what he's going to be talking about today, give you a short overview of the methods that are implemented there. And afterwards, we're going to run hands-on, so then you can actually use the simple Elastix as a package for a specific application, in our case, quantitative MRI. So please, let's have a warm welcome to Stefan, and thank you.
Thank you, Emmanuel. Maybe I should start by introducing you, because you are the second name on this talk, and because Emmanuel actually prepared the whole tutorial that we are that you are going to do. So you will all have to work hard in this session. I'm only going to talk about 10 minutes, I think. So what I will talk about is about image registration, and specifically I will present a method for motion compensation in quantitative MRI experiments, including a software implementation. And then after this brief introduction, you will all have a chance to play with it. Yes, so those are the objectives. We'll introduce this method for motion compensation. It's a method that we developed ourselves in research. It's quite a generic method, so it works in principle for any quantitative MRI experiment. And with quantitative MRI experiments, I mean like T1 mapping, T2 mapping, but also DTI or dynamic contrast enhanced MRI. So after this introduction, I will talk a bit about the software in which we implemented this method, which is based on Elastix, and also a wraparound that's called Simple Elastix. And after that, I'm done, and then you will have to work. And you can try this method out in a Jupyter notebook. Okay, first a small introduction on quantitative MRI. Maybe for many of you it's already known. So quantitative MRI is a technique where you acquire multiple weighted images, so conventional MRI images with different settings, for example, different inversion time or different echo time. And then from those images, you fit a model in order to extract a quantitative tissue parameter. So what you see here is an example for T1 mapping in the heart. So on the top, you see 8 images acquired in the heart. The red dot, so is one voxel, which is plotted here as a function of the inversion time that is different for each of these 8 images. So, and that follows a certain function. And from the theory, we actually know what is the function that it should follow. And so it's plotted here, function. And that function is has a few parameters, in this case, A, B, and the T1. And the T1 is the relaxation time that we are looking for. And so those are the tissue properties at that voxel. So by fitting the measurements with this function, we can estimate these tissue properties. And then if we do that for every voxel, we get a T1 map. And the nice thing of T1 map is it has a unit, so it's really a quantitative tissue property, which promises to be reproducible across scanners. And so it's nice for comparison studies and also for follow-up studies where you want to see if something changes in a patient. Right, and another common example is of quantitative MRI is ADC mapping. So that's based on diffusion weighted MRI. So there, typically acquire a number of scans with different B value. And then again, there's a model associated to that that you fit to the acquired data, and then you get an ADC map. But there are many examples of this. So here I listed the diffusion tensor imaging is, of course, a very well-known example, so the ADC mapping I just told, so T1 mapping, but also T2 mapping, or like combined methods, and then dynamic contrast enhanced MRI. So for every of these quantitative MRI experiments, there's a theoretical model that is fit to a number of data. So, but even the models are very different, but the analysis that you have to do is always the same. All these methods, of course, there are multiple images, and you fit a model through one voxel. So the method really assumes that these images are perfectly aligned. Otherwise, you're comparing the different tissues. And then the model, of course, doesn't fit anymore. So any patient motion that typically occurs, even if it's like on just 1 millimeter, because then you're already in the next pixel. Yeah, so any motion should be compensated as good as possible. So for that, we need image registration. So the method that I focus on here is work by Wieke Huizinga. That was a PhD student in my group. And that was published in Medical Image Analysis Journal. So it's a generic method. But I found interesting, it's a group-wise registration. So typically, if you're familiar with image registration, we're talking about two images. So there's a moving image, a fixed image, and you warp one to the other one. In this case of quantitative MRI, we have more than two images usually. We have, like in this example that I gave, we had 8 images. So then you could either map every image to the first image, for example, or you could map the second image to the first one, the third to the second, etc., to bring them all together. But what a group-wise registration does, it actually takes all these images together, it considers them all simultaneously, and aligns them to each other, to the mean space, basically. So that has some advantages that by registering them all at once, it's using all the information, so and because of that, you get a more robust algorithm. And the advantage is that you don't have to choose some arbitrary reference image like the first one or the middle one, because they're all registered to the mean, basically. Okay, and the second attractive point of this method is that it's model-free. So as I showed, there's many different quantitative MRI methods, all with their own model. But this method does not have to know what is the model. It just assumes that there is a model. So there is some low-dimensional model that describes the data. And then it's based on a principal component analysis. I will not talk about these details. I have some backup slides if you're interested I can explain you. But I want to focus more on the demo here. That's what makes it model-free, basically. It supports rigid registration, but also affine registration or like fully non-rigid registration. And we evaluated it quite extensively, and these results are presented in the paper. So on DTI in the brain, but also ADC in the abdomen, T1 mapping in the heart, and also a joint T1 and T2 mapping in the carotid artery, and finally also in a dynamic contrast enhanced experiment in the abdomen. And actually, later, I think we also tried it on CT, which is a more simpler case, but it also worked on there. Just a few example results that we showed in the paper. On the top row, you see the map before registration, and on the bottom row, after registration. And the differences are not very dramatic. It's pretty subtle because the motion is small, but if you look carefully at the edges, you see that it can really influence the quantitative values that you get out. Yes, so and now we get to the software. So this method we implemented originally in the Elastic software, open source Elastic software. Elastix is a software that I developed myself during my PhD study a long time ago, together with this guy, Marius Staring. And it's a general registration toolbox that does rigid and non-rigid registration. And it's a kind of modular, so it has various similarity measures and optimization methods and transformation models. it also it works with 2D and 3D and even 4D images. And in general, it's pretty fast compared to other packages because of stochastic optimization methods that we implemented. And it works on its multi-platform, and it's free. That's nice. So the interface of Elastic was pretty bare bone, I would say. It's just a command line executable, so with some options. You say Elastic, then you give the fixed image, the moving image, then a parameter text file, and then you say an output folder. And this parameter file also is pretty simplistic. I like that, but some people found this a bit too bare bone. And the nice thing is, because we made it open source, that people can improve on the code. So then there was this guy, Kasper Marstal, who thought, okay, this is a bit an old-fashioned way of distributing your software. So he built a whole wrapping system around it based on simple ITK and benefiting from that. And so in that way, he made simple Elastics, which provides an interface, a simplified interface, from all kinds of scripting languages, including Python, which I think is used mostly. So it compiles Elastics and all the dependencies, and also he implemented several parameter presets. So, but I think the strongest part is that you have the wrappings in Python, and that you can really pass your images in memory instead of having to save them to disk and load them again, etc. And he wrote quite some good documentation on it. So that's what we're going to use here today, because especially for this workshop, so Emmanuel spent a lot of time on creating a demo Jupyter notebook that shows how we can use simple Elastics to do motion compensation in a T1 mapping data set. So there's a link here. Maybe you can already go to it if you have your laptop. First we announced that if you go to this tutorial, that you have recommended that you prepare by installing some things like Simple Elastics. But then we realized it's quite a hassle to install this, even though it's called Simple Elastics. Its installation is not always very simple. So then at this conference, I met Aga Karukuzu, and this is really shows the nice thing of such a hackathon, because in the two past days he just developed the Docker that implements our this entire tutorial environment. So that makes it much easier. If you have Docker on your laptop, you can run this Docker locally. Just make sure you have enough disk space. But he even made it easier this morning. He made this Docker available via binder, so you can just now actually go to the click on this binder button on the GitHub, and then it should work. If you like it to make it a bit more difficult for yourself, or if you already started the installing and you. And you have Windows especially, and you want to compile simple Elastics, then typically there's a lot of errors that can occur. So to make that a bit easier, Niels Dekker, who's here in the front, he was spending last days to prepare a Python wheel, so at least that you don't have to compile Elastics anymore, the simple Elastics anymore. So if you need that, just let me know, then I will share this long link. But
you can also put it on USB.
Oh, that's also possible. Yeah. But in general, I would recommend that you start trying the binder, because I think that's the easiest way. And so if you start the binder, so once it will be started, you will see this view, and then you should select the bottom one, Simple Elastics Workshop. And then once you click that, you should select Tutorial Simple Elastics, and that's the IPython notebook that will guide you through the whole tutorial.
Maybe if someone needs help, you can just put up your hand.
Yeah,
for
I'm going to put my computer there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and Emmanuel has one additional suggestion. There's a small book in it, so he will tell you that you have to type two extra lines in this in a notebook, but that's nice. Yeah? That's nice, interactive.
The launching time for Binder is generally long. So if
it usually takes between 5 to 10 minutes.
Or more.
Yeah, so click as soon as possible as you can on the on this binder. That's the... Yeah.
Well, thank you, Stefan, for the introduction then. Yeah,
no.
Now we can start running the hands-on. I'm going to forget my computer there.
Yeah. Don't clap yet. First, do the demo, and then you can decide if it's worth to clap. do you need the?
No, I have to.
Okay.
And don't forget, so Elastics and Simple Elastics, I believe it is also, they're open source projects. So if you think you can contribute or take a look there, talk to Stefan, talk to Casper or Marius. And I think any help is appreciated, right?
Yes, yeah, good point. There's the whole Elasticsearch is open source. It's on GitHub, so you can also make issues, etc. I would say also for this demo, if you find any things that don't work, you can also make an issue on the GitHub of this tutorial. So then Emmanuel can crunch it. Yeah.
Nice.
Okay.
Thank
you.
Thanks. Okay. So, can I just see a show of hands who is already launching the binder? Oh, basically everyone. So now we just have to wait for it to be launched. There's just one little thing here that it was my mistake that we have to fix quickly. Because of the limitation of space in GitHub, I could not upload the unzipped data that we're going to use here. So, and I forgot to put the unzipping part in the tutorial. So when the Jupyter notebook is launched, please, you can import this Python module, the zip file, inside here. I sent the same message in the Slack group, so if you don't have you can look there what you have to copy. And afterwards, right before you import in the data, you unzip here with those two lines, and it should work, no problem. But so this hands-on is supposed to be you do it, so please read through it, and of course, myself, Stefan, and Ara, we will be here to support you in any doubt you have. Of course.
Yeah, and there is some. Is there anyone here who is going to run this on a Docker container on a Windows computer? Hopefully not. Oh, there is one. Okay, so we need to do some weird stuff. So, okay.
Just one thing I think is really interesting when you're trying to use this in the future for your own application. Stefan talked shortly about a parameter file that is necessary for the execution of Elastics and Simple Elastics. So if you really Google this parameter file Elastics on Google, you can be directed to the database for the parameter files, where we can find a bunch of validated applications for this. And those parameter files, they usually work quite well out of the box. So you can check there if anything fits on the application you want to use. And if not, well, we can maybe develop something together, right? It'll be cool.
Sorry, where do I find this?
There are two options. You can directly Google parameter file Elastics, and it's the first link. It's really easy to find. I will share the link. Probably I'll put in the Jupyter notebook,
yeah,
and share as well in the Slack channel.
Okay.